Good morning. Welcome to the Haywood County Board of Commissioners meeting for September 6, 2016. We'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. If you'd please stand.
Bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, allowing us to live in such a fine place that so many people want to come to. Lord, as we meet this morning together, help us make the best decisions we can for the citizens of our county to make good, wise decisions. Lord, just be with all those out there in our county and throughout our state and nation who are without at this time. In your name we ask this prayer. Amen.
You. At this point, we'd recognize David Francis.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm here this morning to request a public hearing. For the purpose of the hearing is to allow the public to discuss the proposed schedule standards and rules, or the schedule of values, which is the 2017 guide that the county uses in the reappraisal of real property. That hearing I'd like to be conducted at 5:30 on September 19th, but I have a short presentation to go over with you if that's, thank you. All right, 2017 reappraisal. North Carolina General Statutes require that reappraisal of real property in North Carolina be conducted every 8 years. The last time that we conducted reappraisal was 2011. Reappraisal includes both land and improvements on land. Improvements are houses or other structure, could be buildings. The new Chick-fil-A is an improvement to a property. So the properties include residential, commercial, agriculture, and industrial. This process will reset all the market values, or all the land values, back to a market value of January 1st, 2017. So this takes, you know, a lot of information goes through the process to do this. We've been tracking sales from 2011 to present. But the sales that carry the most weight are from 2014, 2015, and of course what's going on in 2016. There she goes. There you go. Okay, part of the general statutes is the uniform appraisal standards, which says all property, real and personal, shall as far as practicable be appraised or valued at its true value in money. When used in this subchapter, the words true value shall be interpreted as meaning market value. This is the process estimated in terms of money at which the property would change hands between a willing and financially able buyer and a willing seller, neither being under any compulsion to buy or to sell, or both having a reasonable knowledge of all the uses of the property is adapted for which is capable of being used. The 2017 reappraisal market value is not determined by the tax office. Rather, it is determined by the actual activity in the market. What the sales are going on between people, not what the county is saying what your market value should be. We're looking at those sales and analyzing those. For example, even though not all properties will sell or rent or be built at the same time, information from those have to be sold can be used to establish typical market rates for each of those market activities. Those rates can be applied to all properties to ensure that a reasonable values can be developed in a uniform way. What it is not foreclosures. It is not short sales. It's not a sale coming from a bank to somebody. Those are not market activity or sales that we review, okay? The county's assessor's office or the commissioners do not create the value of your property. People define the values by their transactions in the marketplace. The assessor's office simply has the legal responsibility to study those transactions and appraise your property according to those transactions. Market value is not always the price for which a realtor may list a price for, or that family members exchange property for. The schedule of values, okay, this is here. It's a schedule of values. Each of the appraisers are well versed in this. And this document was developed by Ron McCarthy. Ron is here with us today. And that he takes information from our market to develop the schedule of values. We don't use information of what's going on in Buncombe County and then apply those values here in Haywood. We use what's going on in our market here in Haywood County to develop those schedule of values. We look at transactions that people are building materials, the cost of labor. We look at those areas to build what it's costing to build a structure here in Haywood County, not in any other county, but Haywood County. So apprising all Haywood County real estate at market value and present use value as appropriate at the time of the county's 2017 reappraisal, the schedule values establishes the base rates and ranges which will be effect until the next reappraisal. It also includes the adjustments that may be used for various types of construction, market conditions, and valuation schedules for land. The tables and rates found in this manual are a base guideline for establishing value. The appraiser uses the guidelines along with market data to make adjustments in order to appraise the individual properties at market value and establish equitable and uniform values for all properties. Reappraisals are conducted by applying mass appraisal. We're evaluating 50,000 pieces of property here in Haywood County. So we use what's called mass appraisal. Techniques through analysts, through appraisal staff, and the use of computer-assisted mass appraisal, or CAMA, software system, the system comparison, cost approach, and income approach, and value are all considered when applicable to appraise the property. Neighborhood reappraisal. As we know, as we introduced neighborhood delineation last time, we will continue to use neighborhood delineation. It gives a defined area to where the appraisers can see the transactions that are happening in this area, not looking over here at Balsam and then jumping on the other side of Canton. We use those transactions that happen in the neighborhood there. This helps us to provide opinion for a typical structure with economic factors and conditions which are in the area that are considered a neighborhood. Appraisers use this information to provide a benchmark to compare each property within the neighborhood with each other. Provide a generally similar geographic area to use as a statistical base for sales comparison both during reappraisal and years later to measure change and updated values accordingly. It provides a basis to allow development of computer-assisted land model tables, or CALP. Market factor. There was some discussion about having market factors last time. Market factors are recognized by USPAP, which is the industry guidelines for fee appraisers and for mass appraisals. And it's also recognized by the Association, or the International Association of Assessing Officers. Market factors are industry standard. You have to have a means or method to be able to bring property up or bring property down when there's sales in an area that you are unable to explain, but they're higher than the values or lower than the values that your models show that should be there. Market factors are only typically applied to the structure, not to land. 2017 was a little bit different than it was in 2011. We added solar farms. You know, we've had a couple of solar farms that have been built here, so we've added that. We've added a lower land model to accommodate lower sales for land. One of the things that we have noticed in the in our tracking and our trends is that our land has remained relatively low or flat. It is a soft market still for land in Haywood County. There are a few areas where land has increased, but overall land is a little bit down from where it was in 2011. We added a section for statistics and appraisal process to explain how we use and make these models more efficiently. What's another thing that changed, present use value, or you heard here deferred, you know, farm, okay, any things like that. Agriculture remained at $495 an acre. Horticulture remained at $1,020 an acre. Forestry went up from $185 to $190. These numbers are adapted from the North Carolina Horticulture and Forest Land 2017 use manual. This is provided to us by North Carolina State, NC State Agriculture. There's several board members all across the state that look at market rents for agriculture. You know, if you're renting your property for it to be used for some agriculture purpose or horticulture, they take all those into accounts there. We're in what's called a major land resource area 130, which is the mountains. And we typically have strong and good rents up here in the mountains for our agriculture production. But one of the things they did change from 2011 is they moved to forestry from 185 to 190. So that was the only change there that we had. So if you were building one of the schedule values looks like, if you're building a 1,300 square foot house, regular square, it's a grade C, nothing spectacular, nothing special about it, just a regular house. The base rate in 2011 was $89.75. The base rate in 2017 is $94.24. So if you built that house right now, your base rate per square is $94.24. The increase was mainly due to the cost of building materials. Labor, surprisingly, you know, remained flat. So most of the increase there was strictly in building materials. Sale data show that vacant land sales for the county have been trending downward, as I mentioned earlier. However, some areas have remained about the same. What we have seen the data showing since then is some areas have increased, some areas have experienced a decrease, and some areas have both increases and decreases, and some areas are about the same. We look at sales about every day, and we have this one neighborhood that had a couple of sales in it. We applied the schedule of values to that. We just noticed that the property increased $1,000. We go to look at another neighborhood, and we look at those sales. We notice that the sales in there have decreased. So it's going to be a little bit of a hodgepodge coming forward in 2017. You know, back in the early 2000s, and then when the market was good, it was pretty easy. Everything's going up. But we're still coming out of, you know, the Great Recession, and things are still soft. Some things have still not hit here in Haywood. You hear that Buncombe, Raleigh, and Wake, the urban areas are definitely going through a renewal, but the more rural communities such as ours have not had that experience. We have seen some commercial, though, that has picked up through there. You notice that on South Main Street, several those tracts have sold and increased in value tremendously. So if you have more information, 2017 reappraisal, this manual, it will be in the assessor's office as required. It's also in the county manager's office, and we have posted the schedule of values online for the citizens if they choose to sit there and read that, because it's a pretty long document, as you see. I'd like to introduce, this is Ron McCarthy with RSM. Now I said Lauren Flynn, she changed her names on me after that, okay. Judy Hickman, our assistant assessor, and Greg West, our appraiser for the county. We've spent a lot of time with this, and we have a good team going forward, and we're going to wrap this thing up close to around the holidays and send out the new value letters out at the beginning of the first of the year. But at this time, I'd like to request the public hearing.
I will call a public hearing then for September 19th, 2016 at 5:30 p.m. in this courtroom. Did anyone have any comments about that? Or okay. All right, then, David, you're still up.
I am. I'd like to bring some very good news to the county. Last year, I received a phone call from the town of Canton that they had been in contact with Western Carolina Freightliner out of Asheville and Hickory in Greensboro, and that they were interested in moving to Haywood County, that they had been in business since 1994. They employ well over 100 people in their corporation, and they wanted to move to Haywood County. They weren't looking for just straight economic incentives. But what they did need, and what the town of Canton did need some help with, was widening the road off of Champion Drive to the property formerly known as the Anton dealership. But we worked on this for a year, and we got this done in late July. And I would like to request a public hearing as part of the North Carolina General Statutes 158-7.1, where we are going to provide infrastructure to the town of Canton to widen an unnamed road for public purpose off of Champion Drive to the Anton building, and to relocate gas, water, electric for the relocation of West Carolina Freightliner. They are bringing over 35 jobs immediately. Their plan is within 5 years to add 60 to 75 jobs. The infrastructure that they're already going to provide is they purchase the property. They're adding an additional 60 feet to the building for the new bays. They're adding a second shift when they break ground, or when they start over here in April of 2017. I think this was a great win-win for the county. When we met with them 3 weeks ago, they already had 3 applications for these new jobs already. So I think it's a win-win for the county, but with the statute, we still have to have a public hearing to go through this.
Okay. All right. If there's no objection, then we'll call for that public hearing to be held on September 19, 2016 at 5:30 p.m. as well, following the schedule of values public hearing.
Yes, sir.
And again, this is for consideration of an interlocal agreement with the Town of Canton for infrastructure and economic development for West Carolina Freightliner Western Star. So we'll schedule that 1 hour.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next up is Lynn Collins, TDA, for a update year-end report.
Good morning. I'm here today to share our year-end numbers for the Tourism Development Authority. We had a very good year this past year. Actually, it's the best year we've had in the history of the tourism program here in Haywood County. On the first slide, you will see our budget projections as well as our actual numbers from the previous year. And you can see that we finished the year end at 17% ahead of budget and 14% ahead of last year. So this is on the 3% side. As you know, we've got the occupancy tax divided by the 3% and the 1%. So this shows on the 3%. You will see in January, February, and March some extremely high numbers. And basically we attribute that to the weather because we basically didn't see winter get here until January last year. So that's the cause for that. On the next slide, we've got the 1% numbers for each of the zip code communities. You can see there in the highlighted yellow line, the comparison with the previous year. Canton finished 16% ahead of last year. Clyde finished 82% ahead of last year. That's primarily due to a lot of the vacation rentals in the Fines Creek and Crabtree area that have come online in the Clyde area. Lake Junaluska finished 41%. A lot of that is attributable to the renovation of the terrace and that being opened back up, so and their increased room rates there. Maggie Valley had an 8% increase over the previous year, and Waynesville had a 20% increase over the previous year. In the Maggie Valley zip code area, the board members have been looking at that because their numbers are single digit, whereas everybody else's are double digit numbers. And so we have been looking at some trending issues to see if we can determine why the Maggie Valley growth rate is not as strong as some of the other areas in the county. So we're working through trying to identify some of those things. So then the next listing shows just some examples of how that 1% funding is being used in each of the different zip codes. You'll see all kinds of different projects there. And as I said, this is just a sampling. We actually had 101 projects that were funded through the 1% last year. So just wanted to give you an idea of all the different types of things that this funding is being utilized for. On the next slide, you'll see just some of the occupancy tax distribution, and also you'll see the gross room night sales breakdown. And if you look on those pie charts, you will see both from the month of June and year to date that also reflects sort of that downturn that we're seeing in the Maggie Valley, that some of the other zip code areas are picking up some of those percentages. We are growing our accounts. We get new accounts almost every week, and so we continue to work on compliance with folks paying their occupancy tax, and we will continue to do so with that. On your next slide, you'll see the occupancy tax breakdown by accommodation category. Probably the most interesting thing here is you'll see across the board that hotel motel is the highest, but if you put the cabins, cottages, and villas and the vacation rentals together, they're almost neck and neck with the hotel motel every single month. The one place that you will see a difference is in December. And December is totally reliant on weather as to whether the vacation rentals do better or whether the hotel motels do better. If we have snow during that holiday season, the hotel motels will do better because people can't get to their vacation rentals. If we have a warmer month where we don't have snow during that holiday season, you will see the vacation rentals do better during the month of December. The next slide just came out from the North Carolina Tourism Department, and this is the economic impact of travel on Haywood County, and this is prepared by the U.S. Travel Association. You will see that tourism in Haywood County generated expenditures of $167.56 million, which was a 3.7% increase from 2014. More than 1,710 jobs in Haywood County are directly attributable to travel and tourism, and this is also an increase. I think the prior year was at about 1,300 jobs. Travel to Haywood County generated $35.76 million in payroll in 15, which is an increase of 8.1% over the previous year. And local tax revenues, this is not occupancy tax, but local tax revenues generated from travel to Haywood County are $6.24 million, and state tax revenues generated are $9.29 million, which is a 7.7% increase over 2014. There are several things that we really attribute some of these better numbers to. Obviously, the economy is getting better. We have properties who have done renovations and who have increased their room rates. We have a new ad agency, which is helping a lot with our marketing and advertising and giving us new creative. We started our group sales initiative this year, and we have seen good growth in that area, bringing groups into the county. And we also have a very creative staff. So it's been a great year for tourism in Haywood County, and we look forward to another great year this year. I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have them.
That is good news for all of us. Any questions of Lynn?
Just a comment that since I'm the commissioner that serves on that board, I appreciate the work that they do. They're very enthusiastic and looking at new trends and new social media stuff, and you know, way above me on that stuff. But anyway, they're out there really working on it. Okay, so it's good.
Thank you. Thanks.
All right, thank you, Lynn.
Mr. Chairman, I have the public comment. My approach.
Pardon?
The public comment.
Okay, we'll move to the public comment session. And the county manager has handed me several cards of people who have requested to speak, and I'll call them off in the order they were given to me. Dr. Kristen Hammett.
Hello, commissioners. Thanks for letting me speak this morning. I am here wearing two hats. I have worked with the County Animal Shelter for the last 28 years, supplying care that they needed at least twice a week. But I'm also wearing, it's not the hat, but it's the shirt of the Friends of the Haywood County Animal Shelter. So I'm speaking from both of those roles. Our shelter, animal sheltering in general, should supply animal welfare, which implies the physical and well and mental well-being of our pets, our animals. They're not all pets. And that's defined in some respect, in some circles, as the five freedoms. And those five freedoms are freedom from hunger and thirst, freedom from discomfort, freedom from pain, injury, and disease, freedom to express normal behavior, and freedom from fear and distress. Our shelter can supply one of those. They don't go hungry. They are supplied with water on a regular basis. And we do our best to supply part of another, which is freedom from pain, injury, and disease. It's not always possible with our current setting. So we've got a 1.5, perhaps, value out of the five that we should be providing. I just left our shelter. This is my morning visit, where we are at 30% over capacity. It is deafening. There's poor ventilation. I had to euthanize two pets, two dogs. because we had no space. Those are the only two open runs that are available now. Many of them are doubled up. We've got cats confined in puppy cages because there's no space for them. There's no isolation. We've got one dog with kennel cough. We have no place to put it, so it's in bike quarantine because it's the only place that's away from our other group. I want us to move forward with the project that we have. It's a project for which we have a site, a plan, an architect, a consultant, and a respected contractor with the lowest of several tightly bunched bids. This projected project for a new Haywood County Animal Shelter has been in the workings for 4 years. Let's approve this bid and move forward. Our group has declared its intent to raise $1 million of the anticipated over $3 million cost. And pursuant to that approval, including alternate A and B, I'd like to present, I suppose I should give this to Julie since she's the county pocketbook, a check for $175,700 pursuant to a positive bid, positive vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Hammond. All right, next up is Jim Bly.
Morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
This morning I'm appearing before you on behalf of the Haywood County Friends of the Animal Shelter. As a retired general contractor, I attended the bid opening. You had six bids ranging from $3.5 million to $3.9 million. And having been part of that process in the past, that's about a 12% spread between the high and the low, and it certainly validates what the cost of the building is based on the specifications that have been laid out by the county's architect. So I would urge you to approve the low bidder in the $3.499 million bid, and we look forward to bringing you another check in the near future. Thank you very much.
I know you're in a fundraising, or you plan to get into fundraising. Are you hiring any professional help, or how's that going to work?
We actually have retained a fundraiser to help us with the project, and we've had signing the contract on hold until such time that we knew that the county was going to move forward with the project. So if we get approval today from the county commissioners on this project and moves forward, we'll be signing that contract with them most likely this evening. We have a board meeting tonight at 7 o'clock. Okay?
All right.
Thank you
for the update. Okay. All right. Next is Connie Hewitt.
Hi. Hopefully this is the last time I come before you this year. It's D-Day, you determine whether the shelter goes forward or not. You've heard the argument so far, and we've supplied you with information, data, statistics. There isn't much more we can do. It's the right thing to do. It is needed, and it needs to begin now. We can't delay this any further. Thank you.
Thank you. Sarah Jane League.
Gentlemen, hello again. As Connie said, we hopefully, not that we don't like talking with you gentlemen at your regular meetings, but we hope very much that we can go forward and have a very positive outcome of today's meeting. I'm Sarah Jane League, and I'm here today to thank you for the vision of a new animal shelter for Haywood County. 4 years ago, a journey began. You gathered, assessed, and validated the requirements. You found the location. You put those requirements into a shelter design for today's environment with the assistance of experts in the shelter design field. You pursued a financial strategy to fund the building of the shelter. The cost to Haywood County residents to service this debt that you've projected is $2 per person per year in revenue from Haywood County sales tax. Members of the community formed the Friends of the Animal Shelter to partner with you to assist in funding this effort. Our goal is to raise $1 million. You and Friends of the Animal Shelter provided the public with education and information on the need for the new shelter and why in today's environment its cost is realistic. You now have before you today the bids for construction to build the shelter. So, today, please vote to build the shelter. The animals of Haywood County deserve this, and Haywood County as a community deserves this. It is the right thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you. And the last person to sign up is Steve Cox. Oh, okay. All right. I've been informed he's not present. Is there anyone else present who would care to address the board on any matter? Okay. Hearing none, then we'll close the public comment session and move to constituent concerns. Michael?
I've had several the last couple weeks, but I've been working with Ira on them, and we're pretty well solving them, I think. Yes.
I just wanted to thank everyone for coming out to the fair. We had a successful fair. The weather was really good for us. I think we had more animals in the livestock part of it that had been entered than we had ever had. And so I just wanted to thank the community for coming out and supporting the fair, and hope they continue to do that every year. And we'll try to make it as the best as we can.
I think the fireman's competition went well.
Yeah.
Fines Creek Fire Department won that. I just thought I'd mention that. So. Kirk?
I don't have any.
Okay. Bill?
Just a comment. We had great weather in Canton for the 2 days celebration, and crowds were enthusiastic, and I believe Canton probably doesn't need any money from us anymore. They had plenty of people there.
That's good.
Okay. I don't have any adjustment to the agenda. Does anyone else? And we'll move to the consent agenda. We've had the opportunity to review the August 15th, 2016 regular meeting minutes. Are there changes to those? Okay. If not, then we'll move to the second item. Julie?
Good morning.
Morning.
I have just a few budget amendments for you. This doesn't sound like it's on. Can you hear me?
If you speak directly into it,
okay.
It's hard.
I'll speak directly
to hear.
Into it. The first budget amendment is for $55,131. This is actually a North Canton Elementary School building project. You'll remember just a few meetings ago, you approved, after the school board approved, a project for ADM funds for the North Canton School reconstruction project. So this is putting it in the budget. $55,131 is the total expense. You'll see that $41,348, which is 75% of the cost of the project, is coming from the state. And the difference, the $13,783, is the county match. We had transferred this amount into the capital project for the schools a number of years ago. You might remember some of the roofing projects had come in under budget, so we had this county match sitting there. So it won't affect the general fund this year, but the budget for the expenses totals $55,131.
Any questions there? Okay.
And the next budget amendment is a state grant. It's the Rural Operating Assistance Program. We call it ROAP for short. And it's the NCDOT Public Transport program for Work First clients for Health and Human Services Agency. We're budgeting $15,161 of the grant funds and putting that into social services so they can use those funds.
Any questions there? Okay.
And the last one I have today is similar to some I brought to you recently. This is actually our special revenue fund, the emergency 911 fund. We had an expense that we were expecting to pay for in the prior year. It was $53,069, and it was for hardware. It was not received by the end of the year, so that money rolled into fund balance of the special revenue fund. So now we're appropriating that part of that fund balance into the current year so that we can pay that obligation that we incurred last year.
Okay, any questions there? Okay, okay. Thank you, Julie. Any comments on the consent agenda? If not, we'd entertain a motion that the consent agenda, as presented, be approved.
So move.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
That's unanimous, thank you. Okay, we'll move to old business. I'll recognize Julie and Dale, Ira.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm pretty sure Ms. Davis is going to take care of the PowerPoint portion of this. What you have in front of you is all the bid documents from our bid opening, our sealed bid opening on August 24th at 3 p.m. here in the historic courtroom. H&M Constructors Division M.B. Haynes was the lowest responsive bidder for the project. My request at this time is to request approval of H&M Constructors bid proposal in the amount of $3,499,000, add alternate number one, and a deduct through the value engineering process, which is still continuing, of $193,500 for construction amount today of $3,481,200.
Okay. Discussion. Do I have any comments at this point? Julie?
We put together a very simple and very short presentation to answer some of the frequently asked questions that we've had about this project. All right, one more. Okay. First question has been, how much will the county borrow from the USDA for the project? That's the United States Department of Agriculture Rural Development. The amount we're going to borrow, the installment loan, will be $3,350,000. How much will the annual debt payment be? $138,131. What will it cost to complete the project? $3,735,700, and that's going to include the equipment, the full design, including alternate one, and all the contingencies. Why is the price higher than the amount borrowed? There are other sources available to cover the cost. What are these other sources? And I think you saw one just this morning. A contribution from the Friends of the Haywood County Animal Shelter and pledged contributions, as well as a reduction in the annual budgeted debt payment that we had put in the fiscal year 17 budget for this project. And to reflect these costs and the sources of payments, we have a budget for the Animal Services Building on your screen right now. You'll notice the construction itself after value engineering came in at $3,015,500. The equipment after value engineering came in at $290,000. And then the alternate number one that was added back is $175,700, bringing the total contract amount that Dale mentioned to $3,481,200. The legal loan, architect fees, and contingencies total $254,500, bringing the total for this project to $3,735,700. And you'll notice the sources equal that same bottom line amount, the installment loan we talked about for $3.35 million, the contribution from the Friends of Haywood County Animal Shelter, the $175,700, and the pledge contributions of $10,000, and then that transfer from the general fund for that reduction in debt service for $200,000. How long will it take to complete? It will take about 1 year to complete the project. How does the cost compare to other shelters in the country? According to a recent study, the cost per square foot of other shelters falls within the average range of $230 to $400. The total cost for the project will be well within this range. The facility will provide for a comfortable and safe environment for our employees, the animals, the public, and the volunteers. Thank you.
All right, I'll open it up for discussion. Anybody have any questions of Dale or Julie or any general observations?
Dale, what was the square footage that they bid?
The project with that alternate one was 13,000 square feet, plus or minus. Without that alternate one, we were about 11,990, something like that.
Well, I got a lot to say. Is that okay?
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
several months ago, I was in the post office, and I ran into the former sheriff, Tom Alexander, and we were talking about the animal shelter, and somebody was talking to him about it, and they were like, this was a new idea, and he said, no. He said, when the county was building the Justice Center and other buildings, that was on a master plan, and it was the last building that the county was going to build. And Tom has been here since, I think he was the sheriff since 1986, so he remembered that, and I thought that was interesting that he would remember that long ago. So before 2002, which is when I was first elected as a commissioner, we had evidently there was a master plan done that had the animal shelter on there. And then in, I think, 2007, when I wasn't a commissioner at the time, but they came up with that we needed an animal shelter that was on a list of capital improvements. So in 2007, that was 9 years ago. And then around 2011, Mark, I think you and I attended a meeting with the Animal Shelter Advisory Committee, and we discussed an animal shelter and the need at that time. And then after that meeting we had with them, I ran into Gene Hazard, who was our animal control director at the time, several times, asking me what progress we had made. And she was pretty persistent on, that we needed an animal shelter. So then a few years ago, we began investigating the cost, and the county, we had a committee put together, and they looked for expertise. We looked to Randy Cunningham, who had some expertise in animal hospitals and animal shelters, and he was able to partner with only two firms from Colorado that were experts in animal shelters. Because if you're going to build this, you want to make sure you get the best design, you use the best materials, and we need to have materials that are going to last for indefinitely. We don't want to put something together just because it's cheap and then 10 years later you're having to replace it again. So we took the step to do that, and we want a facility that meets our needs today and that we can expand and meet our future needs, and I believe that we've done that. The community has questioned the cost, and they should, and I did, after that point, I did some research, and I found out that was a common theme, that communities do question the cost. So, and what's interesting right now, Jackson County is looking at an animal shelter, and I believe it was over $5 to $6 million was what their cost estimates came out to be. And then it was interesting, there was an article just a month ago in the Smoky Mountain News that mentioned that they had hired an architect, and that architect had experience in doing animal shelters between $2 and $4 million, which is exactly where this has fallen. So it seems to me that we are within the range of buildings. This is not a Taj Mahal or anything like that. It's what we need. I think I just want to make that, it's the that it's what we need. And, you know, we had some people question, you know, well, you have your priorities wrong. We're closing schools, and you know, that's a different board's decision to close a school. You know, they've lost 800 students. And so the school board is making a business decision on what they have to do. They probably ought to close another one, really, because of the number of you know, that they've lost. But anyway, that's their decision. But so I did some comparisons. And if you look at what we spend on education, if you add up what we spend on the schools and the community college, and then the debt services we spend there, I divided that per resident per year. It's about $370 a year, and I'm sure I've missed several things. It's probably more than $370 a year. And we're talking about a little over $2 a year for a debt service on an animal shelter. So I don't think our priorities are out of by any means if we're spending $370 a year for education versus $2 for an animal shelter to take care of animals. I think we've taken a deliberate, methodical, transparent approach to this process. And I don't like to you know, my record of the past is I voted against the animal and craft, or the arts and crafts building at HCC. But I had a solution. You know, if they had built a regular building, a traditional building with traditional materials, instead of trying to build a building that was, you know, so-called green with materials that were unproven in a recession, that, you know, they could have saved $3 or $4 million. And I felt like that was the approach they should take. And I had a solution. You know, I just didn't vote against it to be voting against it. I had a solution as the type of building they should have been building. So I don't vote for expensive buildings because I just want an expensive building. I think it's a needed building. I think it's exactly what we need. I appreciate Dale's work with Randy and making sure that he keeps the cost down as much as possible. We want materials that, you know, that will last. And so I don't have a better solution. I think this is our best solution for now, and it should last, and I think it will last the county for decades. The community input that I've gotten was, it's probably 7-1 positive for the animal shelter from the emails that I've received. I have had people tell me that it was a ridiculous cost, and, you know, I have had that. I'm not going to say that it's all been positive, but I have had, you know, I think the showing that we have here today and that we've had in the past of people asking, if we listen, if we do what the public asks, I think that's what the public's asking for. And I don't have a better solution. I think this is the best solution we have. I also think that right now, the interest rate on this loan is 2.75%. Pam Hysong said that was the lowest she had ever seen with USDA. So we can take advantage of a competitive bid, six bidders, right, Dale, that you had? Six bids on a project, that's pretty good. That's pretty competitive, and the bids were pretty tight as far as the, you know, the difference between them. So I think we've got good bids on what the cost is going to be. And if we put this off, building costs, I've never seen them go down, ever. And they're going to go, you know, they're going to only rise. And with this low interest rate, I think we'd be doing our citizens a disservice by not taking advantage of the interest rate. The other reason I'm for this project is I think it helps our community achieve the goal of a no-kill shelter. As I didn't know we were, you know, Dr. Hammett said this morning, she had to put down two animals. I don't think we need to be doing that because of lack of space. I think we're better than that as a county, and I think we need to be taking care of that part of the services that we provided for our county. And so for those reasons, I'm voting for this, and I'll make a motion that we move forward with it if that's what we need at this time. But when that time comes, I will make that motion.
Okay. Anybody else have any comments or observations you'd like to make?
Just one comment. Ira and I have talked about this a lot. You know, in the beginning, we talked about renovating our old building. And correct me if I'm wrong, we're talking about within the space we got, the old building, that would be at least $2 million.
I would have, there are others maybe more qualified, but it would be quite expensive, yes, to to put that figure out there of the
And still not to have the space that you need and still not have the space to expand.
It couldn't, I don't believe it could be expanded because of where it's located.
I'm not sure that it would be allowed in the town of Waynesville now, Dale.
Mr. Upton, just to answer your question, one thing that in that area, and Mr. Schwanger, one thing in that area is the town of Waynesville code of ordinances does not allow an animal control facility in that area. Of course, we've got one there now, so they can't stop it. But the numbers that you're speaking of did not really add on for, this was done in 2000, when we met 2009, 10, whenever it was. These numbers were calculated based on what they needed. It did not really add any animal count to the building. It was basically adding some safety features to the building.
Just within the area they have now.
Yes, sir, that's correct. And you do have a flood hazard area in that section as well. The EMS base is luckily enough out of that, the new EMS base, but it falls back into that category on that end.
So once you start remodeling, you get into different rules from the town of Waynesville. You get
that's
back
correct, and you
permitting.
You,
okay.
We would the county would have to go to the town of Waynesville and ask for a variance from the ordinance to actually be able to do that, and if they would allow it.
Any other comments or observations?
Well, I just have a few and not many. I don't have a whole lot to say about it. You know, originally. And I think throughout this entire process, I've said, you know, that I would support building an animal shelter, and I don't deny the need for that. I think we do need an animal shelter, a new one. I think my questions all along have been, do we necessarily need what has been designed? And I still question whether we need what is designed and whether we should expend that money. I do agree that the debt service is not that much, considering the amount that we're borrowing, that the interest rate is good. I think all those are really good points that normally I would make. But I guess what I have a difficult time with is the I believe it's a little bit excessive. And I don't know quite how we got down that path, but I know we're there. And that's why I don't feel like I can support this project, this design, and this amount. Now, that being said, if this passes today, I will support, I'll continue to support the project. I'm not going to be a commissioner that's against something that continues to pass, and I think I've done that in the past when things don't necessarily go the way I think they ought to go. I would continue to support it, but I just can't. I've staked myself out earlier on this on what I would spend, and it was around $2.2 million. I understand that the Friends have committed to raise $1 million. I don't know if that's going to happen. I believe that the group of people out there, that they probably can do that. But it's not necessarily in the coffers. Also understand that when you don't have a project approved, that it's difficult to raise the money as well. But without going into details about all the issues, that's my opinion on the project at this point in time.
I absolutely support or think that we need an animal shelter. I have had issues with the cost all along. I have had lots and lots and lots of people talk to me about supporting the animal shelter, but had issues with the cost. It seems like every time we started, it was going to be here, and it ended up, it just kept moving up forward. I commend you all on trying to raise the money. I was under the impression a year and a half ago or 2 years ago that was going to start and this money would be in place. It's still about $825,000 from what we need to be. We do have a great interest rate locked in for several years now. So I have a hard time right now supporting the cost that's being presented, as I think personally that we could have done a little bit better on that and possibly had more money raised at this time. So
Okay. As I've said many times, I support this project, and I join in with Kevin and Bill in saying that I will vote for that. So if there's no further comments or observations, I think everybody's had their repeated chances to or opportunities to speak to this, I'll go ahead and entertain a motion that H&M Constructors, a division of the M.B. Haynes Corporation, as the lowest responsible bidder for the Haywood County Animal Shelter Services Building, and approval thereafter for the chairman to sign contract documents with H&M Contractors for an amount not to exceed $3,481,200. And of course, this is pending approval from the local government commission, which Julie will address, and the closing of the installment loan. So I will entertain that motion at this point.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And opposed?
Aye. No.
Okay. That motion passes 3-2. So. Okay, the next item of business would be then to approve a resolution for an installment contract in order to begin construction. Julie?
What you have in front of you is a resolution of the Board of Commissioners of the County of Haywood, North Carolina, approving an installment financing contract and a deed of trust with respect thereto and delivery thereof and providing for certain other related matters. We had put out an RFP for banking. We had two banks respond. TD Bank came in with the lowest construction bid. This is a short 3-year term, and their interest rate, which is a no penalty payoff, is 1.25%, which we thought was an excellent rate for the short-term financing. I don't know if you want me, instead of reading all this, there's a certain number of paragraphs that I think are important to be read.
Okay, we'll highlight those if that's okay.
Okay. Whereas the Board of Commissioners of the County of Haywood, and I'm starting on the third whereas paragraph here, the County of Haywood, North Carolina, has determined that it is in the best interest of the county to enter into an installment financing contract with TD Bank, N.A., in the bank, in order to obtain sufficient funds to finance construction of an animal services building in the county, related site improvements, including on-site parking and utilities on the mortgage property, collectively the project, and enter into a deed of trust and security agreement related to the county's fee simple interest in the real property on which property will be located. And whereas the county expects to discharge this interim contract upon completion of the construction of the project, at which time the county will enter into an installment financing contract with the United States Department of Agriculture, the long-term contract, and together with the interim, the long-term deed of trust, and together with the interim deed of trust, the deeds of trust securing the county's obligation under the long-term contract. And that paragraph is simply talking about the two loans. There's a construction loan, and then at the end of that construction loan, it'll be the USDA loan. Whereas the board conducted a public hearing with respect to the project on June 20th, 2016, to receive public comments on the proposed financing, the contracts, and the deeds of trust, and the county has filed an application with the LGC for approval of the LGC with respect to the county entering into the contracts. And therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Commissioners of the County of Haywood that all prior actions are ratified, that the approval, authorization, and execution of instruments, the county hereby approves the financing of the project in accordance with the terms of the interim contract, which will be a valid, legal, and binding obligation of the county in according with its terms. The county hereby approves the amount advanced to the bank, to the county, pursuant to the interim contract in an aggregate principal amount not to exceed $3.35 million, such amount to be repaid by the county to the bank as provided in the interim contract, including all the proceeds of the long-term contract. And then it goes on to talk about the forms and the terms and all that that you I think have seen. So it'll be effective on the date of its adoption. So that's hitting, I hit a lot of them. I hit most of them, actually, but most of the high spots.
This is common with a USDA loan.
Yes,
we did it at the Walmart building.
Yes, we did the same type of thing. You might remember, though, we didn't have to have interim financing for the Walmart building because we had a purchase that was a large part of that project.
Okay. Any questions, Julie, on the resolution? Okay, if not, then we'd entertain a motion that for approval of the resolution for an installment contract to build the new animal services facility and a deed of trust with respect thereto.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay, 4-1. Okay. And Julie, we'll finish with you on the capital project ordinance.
The next thing I have is to go ahead and put this in the budget, of course, pending LGC approval and the loan closing. But what you'll see on this capital project ordinance reflects mostly the budget that I had shown you on the PowerPoint. The capital outlay building and site prep is $3.191,200. That's the combination of alternate one and the base bid that was the $3,015,000. And then the equipment at $290,000. Those two amounts actually are the sum to $3,481,200, which is the contract that Dale was talking to you about that you approved earlier. Then we have professional services. There's some attorney fees, some legal fees for the loan, as well as some bond counsel. And then we have architect fees that total $111,250. That's the balance left to pay on those. And contingency of $143,250. Those two numbers equal the $254,500 that I mentioned. And then we have the installment loan proceeds, $3.35 million, and the rest is exactly identical that I mentioned on the slide. But this is a project ordinance to put it in the budget so we can start the project.
Any questions of Julie? Hearing none, then we'd entertain a motion that the capital project ordinance, as described by Julie, be approved.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay. I just have one question. Now, the friends had indicated earlier that they would supply the $1 million. How is that million going to be applied to this?
Well, it depends. Once they have the million, I think there'll be some discussion. There is some thought that it would help to cover some of the costs that we have had to repay the county for some of these, or it would be for some of that additional equipment or whatever niceties that they would like. So I think that's still up in the air. That's why I didn't feel like we should budget that full million for this project.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Julie. Okay, that concludes our old business. We'll move now to new business and recognize Lynn Collins with TDA bylaws amendments.
From time to time, we need to make some changes in our bylaws, and so we have a few here to present to you today. Article 1, Section 1, Principal Office. We have changed our address since we moved to the new location out in Maggie in May. So that's reflected there under authority. Members, under Article 2 and Section 4, we have added electronic messaging because all of our notices now are sent via email. Under committees, Article 4, we have added two standing committees, the Group Sales Committee and the Executive Committee. And we have also crossed out, deleted the, where it says the chairman of the authority appoints all standing committees. At our organizational meeting in January each year, we actually have a committee sign up, so each of the members can choose to participate on whatever committees they would like. Under Article 5, the authority shall meet at least 6 times annually. We have just had discussion and voted on going to bi-monthly meetings. A lot of the TDA work is actually done in committee. And once the media plan and marketing plan and the budget is approved for a year, there's not a lot of business that needs to be taken care of on a monthly basis. So they have elected to go to bi-monthly meetings. And once again, we have made a change here about how notification can be made for an excused absence, and it can be made by electronic messaging or by telephone. The TDA board has approved all of these changes, and so we are just requesting approval by the commission here today.
Okay. As Michael mentioned earlier, he serves as our representative on that board. Do you have any observations, Michael?
You know, all this has been really discussed and talked about for quite some time. And, you know, it was approved by the board. And, you know, just like reducing the amount of meetings, you know, it's very easy to call meetings and, you know, if there is necessary business that needs to be taken care of. But most of the meetings are, like she said, a lot of the business is taken care of in the committees, and also the board meetings, a lot of house cleaning and all. So, and informational purposes, looking at, you know, new ideas, you know, what's going on out there, how the social media works and everything. So, you know, it seems to be all in place and good. And they're obviously, with the numbers that they're showing and, you know, of course, with the increase in tourism and a lot of the new advertising that they're using and all, it seems to be working. So.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, hearing none, would entertain a motion that the TDA bylaw amendments as presented be approved.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That's unanimous. Thank you. And we'll continue along with Lynn.
In the 28751 Maggie Valley TDA 1% zip code subcommittee, we have a vacancy. Louis Perrone has resigned his seat on that subcommittee. It's a 5-member subcommittee, and the Maggie Valley Alderman advertised the vacancy and took applications and interviewed the folks, and they are recommending that Gabby Edwards of A Holiday Motel to fill that vacant seat on the 1% subcommittee, and that unexpired term runs through December 2017.
No objection. Would entertain a motion that Gabby Edwards be appointed to fill the unexpired vacant seat on the 28751 TDA 1% zip code subcommittee.
So move.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
No. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. Okay, next up is Breck Lanning, HCC Campus Development Director, with a easement request. And Dr. Parker, welcome.
Good morning, Mr. Swanger. Good morning, Commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. We're here to ask you to approve the easement agreement to allow Duke Energy Progress to install utilities over to the public services training facility, the electric utilities. As you know, that you all hold in earnest the property and the facility that's being constructed for us, we're considered the lessee until the loan is paid off. Our board approved the consent as the lessees at their previous board meeting, and we're asking for consent from you all as the owner.
Okay. Any questions to Dr. Parker? If not, then would entertain a motion that the easement agreement as described with Duke Energy Progress for installation of a new electrical utility connection to the ACC Public Services Training Facility be approved. Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
That's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parker.
Thank you.
Next is Chief Deputy Jeff Haynes with a request to use unauthorized substance tax monies. It's drug forfeitures, correct?
Yes, sir. Good morning, Commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to see you this morning. I come before you today to request the approval of the use of unauthorized substance abuse tax money in the amount of $27,000.32 for the purchase of equipment, ballistic armor, and several other items in relation to our continuous fight against illicit drug sales in Haywood County.
Any questions of Jeff? If not, then we'd entertain a motion that the unauthorized substance tax monies in the amount of $27,000.32 with the approval of equipment and ballistic body armor be approved.
So move.
Second.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Jeff, could you tell us how are things going with that, with the criminal activity in Haywood County? I mean, is it, you see a reduction in it?
Well, obviously there's a continuous problem. That's never going to change with human nature. as it is what it is. Our efforts have been ramped up quite a bit in the last couple of years, especially with the formation of the unit, Unified Narcotics Investigation Team, which is a collaborative effort between the between Haywood County Sheriff's Office and Waynesville Police and the State Bureau of Investigation, and Canton and Maggie Police as well. That has allowed us to dedicate more time and effort to the problems that we have because, as we all know, most of criminal activity is derived from the illicit sale of drugs and so forth. It's a vicious cycle that causes larcenies, property damage, harmful behavior to other people, and injuries and so forth. I would say that our based upon our crime statistics that are turned into the UCR, which is Uniform Crime Report, which is reported back and usually about 18 months behind on statistics, our statistics are basically about flat to where they were at that time as well. Our actual criminal activity is probably up currently a little bit, but the good part is that our closures on cases far exceed, as we produced in our annual report, the national average of case closures. And the good part is, with a lot of the initiatives that Sheriff Christopher's put in place, our recidivism, or return customers per se, has reduced dramatically as well too, which is a huge tax savings for our citizens.
Now, I will say that at least from what I have observed, I noticed the presence of the Sheriff's Department a lot more in the county than I have in the past, and I think that makes a difference.
I've noticed in the rural areas, I see patrol cars.
Well, and that certainly goes to speak well to you for the support that you give Sheriff Christopher and us as well, too. So thank you very much.
Any other questions or observations? Okay, then Julie, I guess you're up for the budget amendment.
Now that you've approved for him to use this money, we're going to show you where we're going to find it in the budget. The $27,000 that he needs is coming from the drug tax that the Sheriff's Department has been accumulating. There's about almost $74,000 sitting there in a fund balance that's restricted just for that purpose. He also has had $2,396 received this year, so I've budgeted that revenue and then taken the difference, the $24,604, from fund balance to use for this project.
What about the 32 cents?
I didn't put the 32 cents in there because we round and that rounds to zero, but he will get his 32 cents. I knew somebody was going to ask me that.
Any questions of Julie? If not, then would entertain a motion that the budget amendment as presented be approved.
So move, including the 32 cents.
Okay. Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. That's unanimous. Jeff, you're back with us for software upgrade discussion.
Yes, Commissioners, thank you once again. And this request is for the approval of a no-cost work order change for CenturyLink as related to the Sheriff's Office 911 Communication Center project, which is up and running as we speak, and has been successful with working out a few little issues and so forth. But with that, there are some software upgrades still to be able to complete the project, and that is a no-cost work order change.
Questions of Jeff? Hearing none, then would entertain a motion to approve the no-cost work order as described. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next up is Ira with the Home and Community Care Block Grant Agreement for 2016 and 17. Ira?
Yes. Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, I am requesting approval of the Home and Community Block Care or Care Block Grant for older adults. Basically, the money has been budgeted previously in the budget process, but this is the agreement that will allow that to be spent, and it's for Mountain Projects that does the congregate meals, Health and Human Services, who does Meals on Wheels, and Interim Healthcare, who provides in-home services related to this older Americans grant. So that's what the MOU basics are for, and Stoney Blevins is the grant administrator on this for the county.
Right. Okay. Any questions? This is an annual occurrence. Okay. Then we entertain a motion that the Home and Community Care Block Grant Agreement for 2016 and 17 be approved.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Thank you. All right, the eighth item of new business is requesting approval of a resolution declaring surplus certain county property. Welcome, Travis. I have Travis Donaldson with us, the interim EMS director.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Come to you this morning with a request to donate an ambulance box. It's currently not in use, not to use the county or EMS, to Southwestern Community College for their use and training future paramedics in their paramedic program there that will hopefully come and eventually serve here in Haywood County.
We have a good relationship with that program out there, don't we?
We do.
Yeah, okay. Any questions of Travis? If not, then would request approval of a resolution declaring surplus and conveying personal property, specifically an ambulance box, to Southwestern Community College.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Okay. And the county manager for appointments to boards. Go ahead, Aaron.
Yes, the first is a reappointment of Eddie Lael to the Town of Clyde Planning Board for the ETJ, and this is approved by, actually for their board, and this is approved by them, by the Town of Clyde.
I would entertain a motion then that Eddie Lael be appointed to the Town of Clyde Planning Board.
Planning Board.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, thank you.
We then have for the zoning board recommended by the Town of Clyde, Robert Wayne Smart.
Okay, we'd entertain a motion that Robert Smart be appointed to the Town of Clyde Zoning Board of Adjustments.
Don't move.
All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you. And the last item of new business, Ira.
Yes, request appointment, and I've been told the name is pronounced Reva Anzaldua, to the Region A Aging Advisory Council.
Okay, we entertain a motion that that appointment be made. Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 It's unanimous, thank you. Okay, that concludes our agenda. We'd entertain a motion at this point to enter into closed session for the purpose of reviewing and possibly approving for release or otherwise closed session minutes under authority of General Statute 143.318.11A1.
Yep. Nope.
Second.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 It's unanimous. We'll be in closed session. We have returned from closed session. Again, the purpose of this closed session was to review closed session minutes from prior meetings. And I'm recommending that the following actions in that regard be taken. These next two would be for approval and release to the public. May 16, 2016, attorney-client privilege, 143.318.11A3. Also on May 16, 2016, a second attorney-client privilege, 143.318.11A3. Entertain a motion that those two items be approved and released.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Thank you. That's unanimous. The following, requesting that they be approved but not released at this time. April 4, 2016, Economic Development, 143.318.11A4. April 4, 2016, Economic Development, same site. April 4, 2016, Economic Development. May 2nd, 2016, Attorney-Client Privilege, 143.318.11A3. May 16, 2016, Economic Development. May 16, 2016, Economic Development. And finally, May 16, 2016, Economic Development. So I would entertain a motion that these minutes be approved but not yet released.
So moved.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
That's unanimous. Thank you. And we have one additional group that would be requesting approval, but no need to review further for release based on their nature. First would be April 4th, 2016, attorney-client privilege, 143.318.1183, and May 16, 2016, personnel, 143.318.11A6, and May 16, 2016, attorney-client privilege, same site. So, I would entertain a motion that those three sets of minutes be approved, but noted that there's no need to further review for release.
So I move.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
That's unanimous. Any other business?
Are we? I guess we have some EMS coming up, right? 9/11.
Yes. There is the ceremony in Clyde, and they're also on Saturday is the event where we hope that the public will come out to honor the different responders. So we have a couple of events coming up this weekend on the 10th and on the 11th.
Okay.
And so the afternoon of the 10th, there will be a lot of things going on Frog Level for people to enjoy.
We'll be presenting certificates of appreciation to the various volunteer organizations and law enforcement and rescue EMS in the county.
Yeah, and I'd just like to take this time to thank all of our EMS, our law enforcement, and all for all they do for our citizens. This weekend, I will not be around, so I will not be able to attend those, and I just wanted to make sure that they know that I do appreciate them.
Yes, but in the fire departments, too, they'll be doing a stair climb in honor of the fallen firefighters, and the public is welcome to help donate to that.
Anything else? If not, would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. And that's unanimous. Thank you.